Hello, this is your RPG check. Welcome back to Let's Play the Pillars of Eternity. White March, Part 1, Expansion, Blind. That's a mouthful. The Devil of Caroc wishes to speak with us.
Village was a touch livelier when I saw it last. Ain't saying much, though.
Her head swivels as she looks around. What do you remember about Stalwart?
Bitter cold and a persistent odor of fish. And that were just the people.
Why did you want to come back, anyway?
Anything's better than Galvino's workshop. You ain't heard the old buzzard sing.
She turns away again.
Anyway, what about you? We've seen lots coming through, trying to crack the battery, but no watchers.
She looks back at you, her black eyes glittering. There's another group that passed through before me. I mean, it's pretty much all these, but there's another group that passed through before me. I need to know what they were after.
Ah, looking for someone. That's a familiar yarn.
She nods slowly, rocking her head on broad, steady shoulders.
But don't let me keep you from the sights and sounds of Stalwart. They're easy to miss.
She rests her hands on her hips and turns to look around. I want to ask you about something else. The black marbles of her eyes scrape against their sockets as she looks at you. Why did you want to come with me?
Stalwart's great this time of year. Bareth spells in bloom for a good 5 days, and the mountain squall actually blows the fish stench away from town.
She turns away, clacking the fingers of one hand against her palm. Okay, now tell me why you really wanted to come with us.
Better than staying at Galvino's, anyway.
Aeloth arches an eyebrow and leans close. I've lived with secrets long enough to know when someone's hiding something. I agree, Aeloth. That's not the real answer. I get the feeling you're not welcome in Stalwart.
I got a reputation. People in these little villages ain't the most open-minded.
She shrugs. Did you murder someone here?
Not yet.
Right. I'm supposed to believe that you came all the way to Stalwart 13 years ago for the scenery.
Believe what you want. I killed a lot of folk, but none of them was in Stalwart.
You answer me pretty quickly. Something you're not telling me?
Plenty. But nothing you need to know.
Huh. She turns away. Galvino said you murdered several people before he transferred you.
Effigies. Eyes that man loved to talk.
Her eyes roll in their sockets. Did you really do it?
Yeah.
She continues to watch you, waiting. Do you regret it?
You want to hear me say yes, don't you?
She tilts her head on its axis, searching you with ink-black eyes. Now I want to hear the truth.
You'd have me go on about how I thought long and hard on my crimes, how I'd spend my own essence if it would quicken the men and women I killed.
She's silent for several seconds before she swivels her head away. Tell me why you killed those people.
If it's sane and logical reasoning you're wanting, you're going to be disappointed. Ain't no sense in any of it.
Something drove you to kill those people. It obviously matters. A soft hissing noise comes from the bronze golem. You recognize it as a sigh.
Mayhap you've heard of Coldmore. Was a quiet, forgettable patch of the woods. Till a pack of rabid clodhoppers set it afire.
The fingers of one hand twitch and click against one another in a pair of sudden spastic motions.
That was the start of the purges. Dear Woodens killing their own.
You're upset. A sudden burst of heat flares from her seams as her essence surges and boils.
A farmer on the other side of the mountains woke up one day with his head on a flame and took it for the gibbering speech of his god. and so did a few thousand of his countrymen. So when he tired of Vorlas fields and marched west, a horde of armed Hicks followed.
You're talking about Widwin and the Saints' War.
Bunch of fool nonsense is what I'm talking about. But others have called it the same. If you know that much, then you've heard of Cold Morn. Ours was the village that let a few thousand of Widwin's troops pass through.
Yeah, I don't know about Cold Morn.
You were from Cold Morn? I heard what happened out there after the war. I couldn't believe my ears.
Fine line between couldn't and wouldn't.
Why didn't you try to stop the Red Sarens?
They had us clean beaten numbers. Even bumpkins like us figured that. Just look at Mercy Vale. They fought back. Now there ain't one stone standing atop another in the whole village.
She sweeps one bronze palm against another, metal screeching.
Besides, we asked the Duke for help. Told him Widewind's troops was coming through the mountains. Seems he had better uses for his soldiers.
The way she ended that off, soldiers. She crosses her arms over her plated chest.
So we let Widewind's soldiers pass. Left him for the Duke to wrangle on his own terms.
You hear a soft clank as she flicks her wrist. What happened then? I want to hear her say it.
They dealt with the Raid Sarens. Then they came for us. Was after the Godhammer made a fine grid out of Widewind, when Deerwoodens were running on rage and looking for something to burn.
You catch glimmers and glints at her seams as razor-thin wires pull tight within her body.
They came at dark. Hundreds of folk. Every one of them mourning someone lost in the war.
A dry chuckle ticks in her throat.
Must have decided it was our duty to escort their dead back to the wheel. They didn't light their torches till they had us surrounded. Time we saw them, there was a ring of fire closing around us.
She pauses, and a mechanism in the back of her skull clicks dully.
I woke. Ran to the window. Whole village were a maze of flames. Couldn't see nothing for the smoke. And the screams.
Her thumb spasms to a strange rhythmic beat.
Most ran for the streets. Got caught by the mob. Others hid, let their houses burn down around them.
What did you do to survive?
Ran, fought, hid, burned. Same as my neighbors and family. Just luckier.
What does that have to do with your crimes? I guess you got revenge against them.
Hunting down the men and women what took part. Thought that much was clear.
It actually was. I just wanted to hear you say it. But you only killed people who attacked Cold Morn, right?
Sure.
Her voice is flat, as expressionless as her face.
You want me to tell you straight? I found the men and women what destroyed my village, and I burned their houses down around them. Sometimes they was alone, and sometimes they wasn't.
She shrugs. You couldn't have hoped to get them all.
Well, we just gotta do our best with what time the gods give us, don't we?
Is that barking with jangling laughter? What exactly did you hope to accomplish?
It were a mob that destroyed our village. But it was just one man that burned my family's house. Kept hoping I'd get to him as I was working my way through the rest of those maggots. No matter now, I suppose.
A sigh rattles out of her bronze skull, but her essence whips and twitches, as restless as a cat's tail. You and Galvino had an unusual relationship.
Only kind to have with someone like him. Or me.
She crosses her arms. How long have you two known each other?
Around about 13 years. Too long, you ask me.
He claimed he made you.
He'd spread butter on bread and claim he made something. Never been accused of modesty, that man.
Her eyes roll wildly.
He managed to stuff my soul into this heap of bronze, true enough. Maybe that makes him a genius. Also makes him a son of a bitch.
She drums her fingers along one scratched bicep. What exactly did you do for him? She regards you for several seconds. She shrugs. We all know where our minds are going right now, guys.
Looked after his tools, cleaned the workshop, swung the sledgehammer. Oh, and snatched up travelers for his soul tinkering.
Those other golems, you mean?
But don't you worry. They were all bad folk.
Fine by me.
Just so you know, you got a real professional working for you.
Speaking of your profession, did you ever consider murdering him?
Every day. Just kept putting it off. It's not like either of us was going anywhere.
You resent him?
No other way to feel about the man who flayed my living soul.
Metal squeals as she shifts her folded arms.
Yeah, I've had enough of him too.
She drops her arms, relaxing her posture. About Durgan's battery.
Just because I'm made of metal don't mean I got any special fondness for smiths and forges.
She flicks the bronze of her forearm, producing a dissonant ring. Do you know anything about it?
No more than what Galvino already told you.
Any thoughts on which villagers I should check?
For fancy dwarven poetry? None of them ever struck me as especially literate. So whichever you can stand to get close to.
She shrugs with a rattling of metal.
And that's on you. I lost my sense of smell 13 years ago.
Do you remember any of the other expeditions that came to Galvino?
Nothing specific. Everyone looks about the same when they got their fingers up their noses.
She pauses thoughtfully, then her head snaps forward in a tiny, quick moment of realization.
Only the last group, one before you, there was something different about them.
Three of her fingers clench in spasm.
Couldn't put my finger on it, but they was dangerous. Almost felt the hair on the back of my neck.
She runs her hand along the smooth, segmented bronze of her neck.
Ain't felt that way about anyone else walking through Galvino's door, that's for sure.
Okay, never mind.
Murder, tracking, and the best materials for kindling. Those are more my area of expertise.
What was your life like before the Saints' War?
There weren't much to say about it. By my reckoning, that means it was pretty good.
She nods thoughtfully.
Ma was a trapper, taught me to set snares and dress game. Dad was a tinker. I never had his patience, but it were fun to watch him work. My brothers and sister, they was good folk too. Part of me's glad they ain't here to see me now.
Her face is as blank as ever, but her essence ebbs and wreathes. She turns away. Alright, that's all. She denied killing anyone in Stalwood, but I'm not sure if I can trust her answer. Well, I guess we'll find out. Oh, I didn't mean to hit that. Okay.
Got it.
And I didn't mean to start traveling alone. yeah, let's go. I'm wondering if even this guy will react to her. I wonder if everyone here might react to her. That'd be interesting. Nope, not any Durgan. How about Thiersch? Nothing different here.
Welcome. Have a seat by the fire if the cold's gotten into your bones.
This wasn't here before. We can read his soul. Thiersch's soul is a vibrant star. Oh, right, because we have that thing. That thing that Galvino gave us. His soul is a vibrant starlit thing. As you reach out for it with your senses, you see your breath begin to fog in the air. You find yourself far above the ground, wedged into the juncture of two branches. The moonlight is bright above the snow, and in the distance your quarry steps out onto the ice as if onto an illuminated stage. You still your breath and draw back your arrow. Warmth bleeds back into your limbs, frost and snow giving way to the smoky interior of Thyrsha's home. Devil of Caroc says, you've got the look of someone with her teeth around a secret. Her cold fingers are locked around your arm. Her black eyes search you.
My, but it's gotten warm in here.
Aloth laughs awkwardly.
Welcome. Have a seat by the fire if the cold's gotten into your bones.
I guess it's not him. Just interesting, though. Head down towards the water. You can tell what's her name. It's Meztla. What we found? Ista. Let me just write that down really quick because I know I wrote her name wrong somewhere. In a video description. Ista.
I hope you've had some luck. And do take care with that device. It has a few rather delicate components.
Oh, we could lie. Yeah, I didn't find any ore deposits, but I did find this.
What? So it works? What a day! But why these gems? I didn't think the device would be able to pick up inert Audra. Fascinating.
Okay, so she took it from us. The device, that is.
I have to study this further. But all the same, it worked! At last! A breakthrough! With that Audra to work from, I can refine the enchantments! We'll be digging up iron, gold, Audra, all of it!
These gems look pretty valuable.
Huh? Oh, I see. But they're far more important as evidence than as trinkets. I can't possibly offer you what Iterant can, but I can give you what coin I do have.
Happy to help.
This is going to change everything. Oh, and I won't leave you empty-handed, of course. Here, I had this set aside for supplies, but I don't think I'll be staying in Stalwart much longer.
Okay. I guess otherwise, if we hadn't said that, we wouldn't have gotten 800 copper?
I won't forget all you've done for me. They'll hear about this back home, I promise you. Who knows? Perhaps they'll name the next battery after you.
Doubt that.
This is going to be fantastic. Just wait till they hear about this back home.
Keep that bronze freak away from me. Now, nobody should be in the Temple of Audra. Oh, we have to go in at night to this fishery. The ogres will be back. They were just testing our strength. Not much to hunt nowadays, and look what happened to Thyrsh. Well, most people aren't reacting to her, I don't know. Should kill the matron while you had the chance. There's that burned house. Meregan will come back to finish us, make no mistake. We'll head to this lady. We can't hear anything. Who's this? I don't even know what that is. Oh, that's the burned house. Give that metal monster half a chance and it'll kill you in your sleep.
Got to speak up? My hearing ain't what it was.
I'm not gonna say much. You feel her essence humming and buzzing. Another personality and set of memories lies dormant within her soul, convulsing as if in fitful sleep. The contours of that dormant soul are sharp, ragged. As you reach out for it, it seizes you violently.
Ooh.
And it gives us experience. You're standing in a darkened feast hall. Sturdy tables and benches have been stacked against the door in the far end of the room. You know it won't be enough. A few dozen other dwarfs from your tunneling crew wait with you, shovels and pickaxes in their shaking hands.
Sinove, please. If we go now, we can get behind the barricade. We won't do any good here.
One man turns to you. He's right, and you hear agreement in the quiet murmur of the others. But Arms Warden Maroon ordered you to hold your ground here. Yet in those rising whispers you hear the opening bars of mutiny. You've never tolerated insubordination from your crew, and you aren't about to start. So you heft your pickaxe and swing it into the man's skull. He collapses, and the others fall silent. The acrid odor of urine rises from his body. Well, this has to be it, guys, especially since we got all that experience.
We're gonna go down fighting. Anyone who feels differently can settle it with me right now.
Your voice is hoarse from hours of shouting orders, but no one else moves. They cast their eyes down into the flickering torchlight. Something thuds against the floor. The others raise their weapons, picks, shovels, and a few swords, but they don't dare flinch. Your own pulse pounds at your temples. You pull back from Tana's soul, but you feel Zenove's wrath and ferocity tugging at you still. Her essence thrashes, lashing out at an unseen enemy. Zenove is powerful, but dangerous too. Her fury has anchored her to old and threatening memories. You consider that there may be others you could awaken. Tana, however, seems unaware of any of this, and she blinks back at you with cloudy, placid eyes. Awaken, Zenove, and remember your battle in the feast hall. A tremor passes through Tana's face, and then her rumpled skin goes slack. After a racking cough, she blinks like someone slowly coming to consciousness.
That name. It carries memories of death, war, fury, the taste of blood. What do you want with it?
Her eyes have grown unusually clear. Durgan says, this one's far stronger. It will devour her from within. Replace weakness with strength. Durgan glances at her and lowers his voice. But it may not be to your benefit. Well, I don't know if I can unawaken her now. I need to enter Durgan's battery.
What trickery is this, stranger? You think a Pargrin would so easily betray her own people?
Her hands clench and unclench around an imaginary weapon. Zenove's essence stirs with the same battle-ready furor you sensed in her memory from Durgan's battery. She is dangerous. Beneath Zenove, Tana's overwhelmed consciousness struggles. The last of your people disappeared hundreds of years ago. There's nothing left to betray. Zenove's rage is a heavy fog that clots and thickens, choking Tana's fading consciousness. Zenove herself is overwhelmed, and she forces Tana's eyes into narrow slits.
Lies! Arms Warden Maroon will see you cast into the White Forge!
Look around. Would you be here, stuck in an old woman's body, if I were lying? Zenove at last overwhelms Tana, screaming through the old woman's mouth. In that instant, Zenove's psyche expands, filling you with a lifetime's worth of memories and experiences, including a set of verses that you know to be the cantech of Durgan's battery. Ooh.
Hammers of Durgan, ring loud. May the anvil's deep music resound. Walls of the battery, safeguard our works from marauder and wilder alike. Abidun's faithful travail by the forge and the fires that brighten the ore.
Okay, so she told us this. I guess we kind of, it's almost like we read her mind, that all her memories came out. It's too much for Tana's dying consciousness. It shrivels and vanishes as Zenove, now in full control of Tana's body, attacks. Oh boy. Aren't we still fighting an old lady, though? Tena, the old overseer of the mine, is the sole descendant of a hot-tempered woman named Zenove. As violent as Zenove's final memories were, awakening her could be a risky proposition. There may be someone else in town I could awaken. Well, it's too late.
Got him.
Okay. I heard the cantech from Zenove, a dwarf who lived and died in Durgan's battery. Unfortunately, Zenove took over Tena's body and attacked me and was forced to kill her. And here's the verses. Taxes. Everything's still completed. I'm ready to enter Durgan's battery. I have the relief fragment that the lead and key expedition found and the cantech I learned at Starwood. Okay, we've already put the relief fragment on the door. Okay, well now we can look through her stuff. A fine dagger and Starwood bony. Pretty sure I looked at this already. These teeth have been sanded smooth in preparation for carving.
I'll have it in no time.
Oh, have the guy...
I can do that.
This guy do it. Fine robe and a hooded turban. Potion of minor recovery. Bronze Abaddon statuette. Many households in Durgan's battery had a statuette of Abaddon that was cast in the White Forge. The original was made by a renowned Aptapo sculptor. And the stag-eyed. Oh, she's dead. She won't be needing that stuff any longer.
Fine.
I think it's fine. Can we awaken other people? Do we want to do that? I still want to see how other people react to her. Oh. Definitely. Basically, only people left the Renning Guild and Graves Rest and people outside. Meztla of the Sisterhood of the Slake Skull is dead. He grins. Kinda ironic, isn't it? She went around killing people for Barath, and in the end, that's what. Oh, never mind. Just take the bounty. He passes you a bag that rattles with coin. Okay, 3,000 copper. Nice. Some experience. I've heard some new reports of dangerous folk about. Perhaps you'd be interested in going after them, too. Sure. That'd be the Disciples of the True Flame in the old Dunreed Hunting Lodge. He shakes his head. Those others you handled are lambs by comparison. What? Tell me about the Disciples of the True Flame. He scratches the back of his neck. I didn't know what to make of this one, but word is it's a group of dragon cultists. He holds up his hands. I know it sounds bizarre. I didn't believe it myself until I heard they torched the outpost north of Maiden Falls. For clearing a nest of worms, they said. Where's Maiden Falls? Last I heard they made camp near Longwatch Falls. They shouldn't be hard to spot. I think we'll go into Durgan's battery first. What's the old Dunreed Hunting Lodge? He shakes his head. Adherents with too much time and money. They travel around hunting monsters for sport. But they leave a mess of wrecked property and dead bodies, kith, I mean, in their wake. They've been charged with murder and general mischief in Defiance Bay, New Hamar, and a dozen other towns in between. Someone saw them hunting in the Russet Woods, so you might look for them there. That's it. Lanrick, leader of the old Dunreed Hunting Lodge, is wanted dead. Though he and his group ostensibly hunt animals and monsters for sport, they have a habit of leading dead innocents in their wake. Last seen in the Russet Wood. And a bounty has been placed on a man known as Firedorn. He was last spotted setting up camp in the wilds around Longwatch Falls. him and his disciples of the True Flame have been murdering anyone who dares to hunt dragons in their kin. Someone has reported that this senseless violence comes to an end. Someone's requested that this senseless violence comes to an end. Yep. You know, often we hear such fine manners up here. Good day to you, too. Lane wreck? Oh, I've seen that already. Rayfald?
Hey there. Let me know if you need anything.
Read his soul. The snowy paths peel away, and the brisk air gives way to the acrid stench of smoke. A dark cloud billows up from the remnants of a burning house at the far edge of a rocky field. You are low to the ground, held in place, and above you, the wind tugs embers back and forth like firebugs.
Not so brave now, are you?
The vision in your left eye is clouded, such that the figure standing over you is a collection of rough smears of black, cast in silhouette by the fire. A dark shape swings towards your face, and the subsequent burst of agony jars you out of the memory and back into your own skin.
What? Did I spill something on myself?
Rayfar looks down at his clothing. Farewell.
Hey there. Let me know if you need it. Sure. Ask away. Right. Any-
Yeah, let's go talk to these guys in here, Renengild and Sun.